We're here for Windrush Day today, and the flag that Roy will be raising soon says we are standing on their shoulders, and it's something I'm acutely aware of. When I was elected and it was pointed out I was the first black mayor in Europe, you know, my election did not happen in an abstract. Myself, Ashes, political opportunities, you know, the opportunities for everyone in Bristol from our black communities who have gone on has been because of the generation that came before that fought, sometimes physically to make space, but fought for equality in the workplace, fought for housing, fought for to establish our communities. And where we are today wouldn't have happened without those people going through their fights. And as we look around at the state of politics today, and we think about the Windrush scandal and some of the other political scandals that have gone on, it just is now more than ever so important to understand the full history of Bristol, the full history of our country, and the contributions made by our communities to making this country what it is today, better than it would have been without us.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure to be here, to see so many people around helping us to put up the Jamaica flag in this county. I'm very proud for the mayor, the Lord Mayor, and all the other people that are here today to say, I'm not too well, but I'm well enough to speak about what is happening here, which is very good for most of us. And I hope everybody would think that they're doing a good job for us. And I wanted to say that I am satisfied that things have been done in the right way as far as I'm concerned. And I want to thank the Lord Mayor first, then the mayor after. And I want to thank you all to be here, honestly, because I myself cannot do anything without help, but I will have them to call on. I hope they'll be there for a long time. Thank you very much all, okay? Thank you.
It's to read out the speech today, but what it's really appropriate is to say a big thank you to you. Roy, thank you so much for taking the time to come here today, and it's absolutely magnificent to meet you, and it's a real testament to your contribution to the city that you are a living representative of your community in Bristol. And I think that's really important, because the United Kingdom and Bristol were in a pretty powerless state at the end of the Second World War, and a call went out to your communities to ask for help to rebuild Britain, and you answered that call. And I know that the reception that people got wasn't always good, and you were treated with less than respect, and that's not acceptable. But over the years, your community and the Commonwealth communities have made an increasing contribution to the economic and the cultural life of particularly Bristol. And I think that Bristol is a much richer and diverse place because of the contribution that you and your fellow colleagues made when you came over to answer the call. And we are living in a much better place because of the work that you have done over the years. So thank you so much for coming today. It's been an absolute pleasure to meet you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to start by thanking Forward for inviting me and Bristol City Council for facilitating this event. To our honoured speakers, my respect and regards. And to the Windrush generation, as we would say, manners and respect. And regards to all my fellow citizens. And I'll introduce myself. I am Jagun Akinshegun, and I am of the Windrush generation, just about. But I'm also a child of parents who is of the Windrush generation. And I think people have spoken about it so many times, what a dreadful thing that has happened to our people in this Windrush scandal. Denying their rights, access to health, jobs, and their legal status. And so many of our families suffer through that. And it's not just the people who were directly affected, it was our whole community. And since then, I don't think any of us probably sleep as soundly as we did, especially when immigration is being discussed. But, you know, before the scandal, I recognized the greatness of our generation. Well, not so much my generation, but the previous generation. You know, people who came to this country to plant roots. And we could compare them to any migration in the world that's happened in the world, whether it be from biblical time or wherever. But I would also like to say something as well to thousands of white mothers and fathers, of our descendants, our children, who suffered like we did in many ways. And probably I could read Shakespeare's words to describe my feelings to them, where from Henry V, where he says, "For whosoever sheds his or her blood with me today shall be my brothers and sisters. However humble his or her birth, this day shall grant him nobility." So I regard those white mothers and fathers as part of the Windrush generation. But I have to ask myself, and people should ask, all ask Christoph, what came out of the Windrush scandal? What tangible result came out of the Windrush scandal for our people? And if people are going to say passports, people are going to talk about compensation that none of us seems to can get. No. There was no result. Those were things people were entitled to. But I'll tell you what came out of that. It was the appointment of Sajid Javid. That was the most important, the first non-white person to be appointed to an office of state. And his appointment was like the naked emperor moment, where everyone knew why he was in that place, but nobody said. We knew what was happening. Theresa May was prime minister of the time, Amber Rudd, and the Brexit debate. And we know what that came to in terms of Sajid Javid being appointed to that position. But what we find upsetting is that he that did not clearly acknowledge that this was a result of the Windrush scandal. And later on, when he moved to the Treasury, there was, as far as I can see, nothing positive that was done for us. And then he's replaced by Priti Patel. And we can see recently our reaction, whether it be to the pulling down of a human trafficker statue, or whether it be the Harry and Meghan story. I'm not a royalist, by the way, yes. But it was notable, her response. And we, from the Caribbean community, we feel like too often we have opened the door to positive changes, whether it be the St. Paul's Uprising, the Windrush, Causton statue, or our footballers who are fighting racism. So we feel like we're always holding the door, or we're initiating changes, and others file past us, not even acknowledging our suffering or our contribution, not to mention giving us our fair share. And we cannot keep holding the line, because we're fighting to a rear and we're fighting to the front. So we cannot keep on holding that line forever. And recently, after the pulling down of the slave trader statue, Lloyd's Banking and Insurance Group announced they'll be setting up funds for the ethnic minority groups and charities because of their involvement in the slave trade. But I say to that, no. We, the Caribbean people, is still the one who's suffering the consequences. And any government actions or anything from organizations like Lloyd's, it should specify that the Afro-Caribbean community and poor working class white people are a priority, because we are the one to suffer. Whether it be around Liverpool or whether it be around Bristol, white poor working class people suffered as well. And I believe they should be. On a point of principle, they should be, and politics. The pulling down, I have to refer to the pulling down of the human trafficker statue on the 6th of June. For us from the Windrush generation, that was the greatest thing to happen in our city for years, for decades. We have to suffer the indignity of that monstrous symbol of inhumanity. And for those who say it was undemocratic, I say we need to look at how democracy is working in Bristol. Because for too long, so many people, the majority of people, wanted that statue to be removed. But because of money, influence, and power, it was not. And let me commend the skill and bravery of the senior police officer. Surprise. I'll show you surprise. Coming from me, that is a surprise. Because for their successful policing of the event. Because at the same time, we have to know that they were holding back the foot in your throat type of officer, and alleged interference from the Home Secretary, criticizing and urging them to use force. And if they did that, it would have been mayhem down there, down at the waterfront. People would be dying. And so, you know, we have to criticize them when they do bad. But when they do good, let's also say it. And we send our condolences to George Floyd family and people of America fighting police murders. We thank all the key workers and volunteers who working hard to keep us safe in this pandemic. But I want to finish with a message to our young. And I'd say this to our young. We see your hurt and struggles. We support and love you. We're happy how you're growing and is proud of your achievements. Learn from our lives, our struggle, our successes. Yes, even our failures and our mistakes. But be vigilant so we don't have another Windrush candle. And I say, be merciful and protect the weak. But above all, be strong in unity, not only to defend, but to defeat those who will suffocate, shoot, and deny you your rights. And I would say to them as well, don't just say Black Lives Matters. Say it with force. We assert Black Lives Matters. Thank you.
As a young person, I'm truly honoured to be taking part in raising greater awareness for the Windrush generation and to be taking part in this event. Today marks a celebration for those who have contributed to our communities, culture and society, helping our public services and economy to thrive. People have made our country even stronger, more vibrant and more successful. And I doubt that any event that we would be able to run would be thanks enough for that. I believe that it is our duty as young people to understand the history of our country and our city. And as such, we must learn about Windrush and the Windrush scandal. I also believe it is our prerogative to strive for a more inclusive and equal society for all those who live in it. I truly believe that it will be our generation that affects the most change yet. It is deeply important for young people to be included in the conversation surrounding Windrush to ensure that we continue to learn about our history. We acknowledge the Windrush generation not only through this special flag raising, but also during the many worthy events and projects that instill a real sense of belonging. And it is through our collective work and responsibility we are all here, raising the standard of Windrush.